wrestle with Satan in the garden? He was wrestling with whether he was going to die on that cross for us. Was that a battle with temptation? Wasn't he tempted not to go? He who had known no sin wasn't just going to die for it. He was going to, as Scripture says, become sin for us so that we could be set free from sin. Did he know what was ahead? For how long has Jesus, and if, as we've been studying through the Gospel of Mark over the last, what's it been, a year and a half or more, again and again, Jesus is telling the disciples, I'm going to die, I'm going to be crucified, I'm going to suffer. I'm going to Jerusalem for that very purpose. Did he know how much it was going to hurt? He had a pretty good idea. Even when Jesus was a young boy, they had crucified a few hundred rebels in Jerusalem. And Jesus would have seen that when he had gone to Jerusalem. The torture of the cross was horrible. Did he know what it was going to be like? He's God. He knows what's ahead. He knows the pain, the anguish, the difficulty, the challenges. He knows how hard it's going to be. And no, evil doesn't want him to die on that cross. See, Satan, really, you remember the temptation? Satan, when Satan came to him, tried to offer him other ways of becoming the Messiah. Because Satan did not want Jesus to die. Satan did not want Jesus to pay the price for our sin. So was Satan there in the garden? I don't know. But I know that the battle was so intense that Luke, even in describing the battle, says that Jesus was sweating as of droplets of blood. The words that are used here are words for depression and anxiety, are the strongest words that we have in the Greek language and in the entire New Testament. The intensity of Jesus' battle is probably as great as any of us can imagine, if you can imagine some very trying, very frightening moment for you. In the past few weeks, we have learned that Pete Giacoletti has what he first was told, stage 4 cancer. We were told that when he told me about it, that, yeah, Bill, they found cancer in my liver, cancer in my pancreas, cancer throughout the abdomen. And they've told us that they can't do anything for it. So doctors and all have talked and said, well, we're going to try some chemotherapy to try to reduce the size of the tumors. He started chemotherapy, I've lost track now, sometime right before Christmas, and had some chemo at that time. He then, they continued to search because this all started because, by the way, Pete had cancer of the larynx about 15 years ago or something like that. Intense radiation that they did to him, and so he could not swallow normally. In fact, that flap or whatever it is, and I'm not a doctor, so don't make me be scientific for you, just give you the idea, okay? The flap that's supposed to cover the throat that makes it so that food doesn't go down into your lungs, that flap is basically, for Pete, a stiff board. And it's gotten worse. Well, he was having greater and greater problems with swallowing, so that's why he went in just say, you know, I'm having swallowing issues. Can't we find out what else? Is there something else we can do about this? And that's when they found all the cancer throughout the abdomen, through all his internal organs. And then later, did some more work and found that he had a new growth on his throat, and that was a different form of cancer. So it's been about 2 weeks ago that they did a chemotherapy, and he decided to do a double dose for both of the different cancers in his system. One of the things that Pete said is, you know, Bill, I know where I'm going. At first, they thought that they had months. And at one point, they were told that this could be 12 months to 36 months. Could be a year to 3 years. Then suddenly, it looked like it might be days. And in fact, last week, Pete was in the hospital. They did put a feeding tube in. That feeding tube or something with inside appears to be leaking. And now there was infection in his system. And last Sunday, he was in the hospital and almost died from the infection internally. They did find that the feeding tube was not causing the leakage, but that meant that there's some other kind of microscopic leak somewhere in his system, and the only way they would be able to find out where it was and to seal that leak would be to take and do a surgery that would open up his entire chest cavity, remove all of his internal organs and intestines, and basically look over everything, and even then maybe not find the leak, put everything back in, and they said the recovery from that would be excruciating if he survived the surgery. Pete and Ann obviously decided not to have the surgery. Finally, on Friday night, about 11 o'clock or midnight, he finally made it back home, and he has come home on hospice care. And they are going to simply try to keep him comfortable. The good news in all of this, for the immediate good news, was that the feeding tube is not causing leaks, so they're going to continue to use the feeding tube and give him some nourishment. Otherwise, he was going to come home with no nourishment. He is very close to heaven. I don't know what God's will is. One of the things that Pete's most concerned about is his family. And of utmost concern is his burden for his bride, that he doesn't want to leave alone. Pete has served as our treasurer for something like 14 years. Through a variety of different seasons, and for some of you who have been here for a while, know that those seasons sometimes have been rather rocky and just a bit on the challenging side. And I have to say, with no embarrassment, Pete is one of my closest friends here at this church. We get to do a lot of sharing. We talk a lot of politics. Yeah, has some different opinions than I do. We talk about evolution. We have some different opinions. But we both love Jesus. And I would like to invite us to pray for Peter right now and for Ann. And if one or two of you really feel moved to come pray, I'm going to grab the microphone. And if one or two of you feel like you would like to pray as well for Pete, then would you please come right now?
Test, test. Lord, my heart is burdened for Peter, one who knows you and loves you and cares for you, as we care and love him, Lord. Continue to comfort him. Comfort the family and encourage them as they face this time, knowing full well the prospect outcome. Continue to bless them, Lord. Draw ever closer near to him. And to us, Lord, as well, as we face this time of loss, of one we care about and cherish, Peter Giacoletti. Amen.
God, I pray that you would do the miraculous. Lord, I don't know if it's your will, and so I'm asking you to show us what your will is for Pete and for Ann and the entire Giacoletti family. What I do know is that you've said to ask, and it will be given to you. You've invited us to actually come before you on behalf of one another and to pray. And Lord, to the best of our ability right now, we're agreeing in this room for a miracle for Pete. God, I even thank you for the miracle that feeding tube still working in. And Lord, just what that means. I thank you, Lord, that he's able to be home right now. I thank you, God, that he's having this time to talk to family, to love them, to share with them, that he even had the opportunity to stand there at his granddaughter's wedding and give her away and dance with her afterwards. Lord, there's many blessings you've already given to Pete and to Ann. And I thank you for them. And I pray for Pete's burden that is not a concern for himself, but a concern for his bride. I pray, God, that you'll help the family to really take care of her, and that will be evident even now. Thank you for Jessica, who's able to actually be there, staying there, and be there for Nana and for Papa. And Lord, sure would be great if you'd heal that cancer. I know, God, that there's a resurrection coming and a healing that will happen, even if it doesn't happen in his physical body. I know it's going to happen as you take him home. But in the meantime, God, may you be glorified through his life, and may he know that he's loved and cared for. In Jesus' name, amen. Paul, you were going to pray.
And Lord, you do take us through seasons, and you allow us to go through seasons. And I pray that in this season you would bless and protect Pete and his family. But I also pray, Lord, that you would show us as a body how to care for and love one another and pray and come alongside and listen, especially listen, Lord, and comfort. And the Lord, that as we've taken our covenant in the last few weeks, Lord, that you would remind us daily, weekly, how to be the body of Christ to one another. We long for our ability to submit as you submitted. So please use us.
Amen. So what is God's will? How do we know it in times like this? How did Jesus know it? Jesus knew he had come on a mission. That mission was to come and to die on a cross, to take sin, to pay the price for sin, to buy our forgiveness. He knew that was his purpose. And throughout his life, we see him again and again. You remember in the temple, 12 years old, mom and dad come looking for him. Didn't you know I had to be about my father's business? Where else would you expect to find me than right here in this place? What we know is that while we don't know whether, does God want to heal Peter? I don't know. I know I'm going to keep asking that. I'm going to keep asking for the healing until he tells me I'm not supposed to. And I'm also going to keep asking, so what is your will? Because I'm going to try to understand that, because I believe that God tries to show us his will. One of the big things we do know is that God's will was not for us to die, but sin brought on death. And that God's will is to set us free from that enemy of death and ultimately to give us new life in heaven. So what we know is that this life is not the end. The life to come is something that is even better than what we've experienced here. And that sometimes, most of the time, we don't want to leave here. Because this is where we're comfortable. This is what we know. But we know that God's going to take everyone who believes in Him, who accepts His death on that cross and His resurrection, He's going to take them to be with Him in heaven. Question. How many of you have had surgery? Drop your hands. How many of you have had major surgery? Whoa. Here's what I heard. Major surgery is surgery on me. Minor surgery is surgery on you. I'm having minor surgery this week. Tomorrow I'm having my gallbladder removed. I've had 2 months of intense pain. I know I hide it, or maybe most of you do know it. I've had intense pain for the last 2 months. They finally decided, okay, we're taking your gallbladder out. And I get to be one of three people that my surgeon is going to have on his list that have intense pain in their gallbladder. Most indicators don't show it's gallbladder. There's no stones or anything else. But he said, but the pain will go away when the gallbladder is removed. I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to not having this intense pain. By the way, if any of you had gallbladder surgery, please don't tell me any details right now. Okay. And unless you can tell me I can eat ice cream, I don't want to hear any more details, okay? Now, if I ask you, then just be nice, okay? But kind of keep it a secret, okay? I had to sign a document at the doctor's office on Thursday when I'm about to leave the surgeon's office, and because we've been trying all different things, and the surgeon says, he's talking to his receptionist, and the receptionist says six, and he says, hey, William, can you do it on Monday? No. Yeah, okay. Well, let's get her done. And so they quick, well, here, sign these documents and all. Here, look at what was on this single sheet. By the way, this is all that it is. This is the sheet right there, okay? Simple sheet. Got three signatures on it. Mine, plus my printed name, a witness saying that I signed this, and the doctor saying that I signed this. Listen to what I signed. General risks and complications. By signing this document, I acknowledge that there are risks associated with every surgical procedure. This includes, but is not limited to, pain, yeah, bleeding, I'm looking forward to this, scar, I don't mind, infection, that's not a good thing, injury of the bowel hernia, what is that? I don't even know. Reoperation or death. Risks associated with sedation or anesthesia includes, but is not limited to, adverse reaction to anesthesia and death. Alternative methods of treatment, don't have surgery. It just says no surgery. Signed, witnessed, and signed by my physician. This sounds pretty serious, kids. Why do I read that? Because I had to sign this the other day. So, it's like, as you're getting ready for surgery, what do they want you thinking about? I might die. Or, I might live, but I'm going to have a bowel something or other. Okay? And if you've noticed, the more I start to think about that, what's that going to do to my emotions? That's why I don't want any of you telling me any more details. I had an endoscopy on Monday where they put one of these things down your throat, a camera and all that kind of stuff. They go clear down into the small intestines, all through the esophagus and all. I want to thank those two people who sat at my table last week on Sunday morning that I just happened to sit down for soup, and both of them told me about gagging while they were having their test. I just want you to know how much you encouraged me getting me ready for Monday. Okay, I'm trying to make light of this partly because I'm worried. No. Because When Jesus was getting ready for that cross, he was very human. Very human. When he was anticipating the anguish of that cross, he knew what to expect. And he had reason. He signed a much more serious document. He signed saying, I'm going to die to give them life. And I know that the result of my choice, my decision to go to this cross, I know that the result of that is my death. I know that as a part of this, I become sin. I know. The Bible's talked about it. Old Testament's full of it. I'm going to be rejected. I'm going to be despised. My Father in heaven, that part of me that is divine Father, is going to turn his back on me. I'm going to take this alone. I know that this is going to be the loneliest moment of all eternity. I know this is going to be hard and physically and emotionally painful. And I'm not looking forward to it. Mark, the 14th chapter, verse 32. They went to a place called Gethsemane. And Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Stay here and keep watch. Going a little farther, he fell to the ground and prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. I wonder. Do you think Jesus really could have avoided the cross?
Yes.
He could have said no. Do you think he was tempted to not give his life? Most assuredly. Do you think there was a terrible spiritual battle and an emotional battle for Jesus going on? Of course. You see, while Jesus was fully God, he's fully man. He's fully human. He feels the anguish, the anxiety, the stress, the pressure, the pain. Mark says he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. The word there is a word for being thrown into terror. Jesus is being so stressed out by this that terror is gripping him. He's troubled to the point that the word is that he is heavy, depressed. In fact, as I mentioned earlier, it's the strongest of the three words in the New Testament for depression. His anguish is real, folks. Just because he's God, he's not avoiding the pain, the fear, the anxiety, the pressure. Jesus says to the disciples, and next week, Dylan Roquet, our youth minister who works with our youth on Wednesday nights, is going to take this part of the text where he's going to look at the disciples, and I think he'll take more on this one statement and their reaction. I want to look at Jesus' thought. My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. To get ready for next week's sermon, I want you to think about how you would have reacted if you had been with Jesus and he said that to you. Oh, well, too bad. Oh, yeah, well, I've got these problems too, Jesus. Could you be concerned about mine also? Because the fact is, so often, isn't that how we kind of react to God? Well, that's for next Sunday. Jesus said, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. I'm very, very sad. I've got sorrow that's just, it's just getting heavy for me. It's weighing me down. It's overcoming me to the point that I'm afraid it's about to kill me. I feel like I'm going to burst from the inside out. This pressure is becoming so intense. And that's the one aspect, one of the aspects I appreciate from the video of the Passion. At one point, you look at it and you say, oh man, they're really making Jesus look.